strike, the new allegations, and whether it'll make it harder for Catholics to keep the faith.
Late breaking.
The first underwater look at the oil spill disaster, the rush of fuel that's been going strong for 3 weeks now, and the blockbuster movie franchise that'll transform part of Central Florida into a Hollywood movie set. Western News 10 at 10 starts right now.
First tonight, school scares, a sudden barrage of threats, weapons, and worries. Good evening. I'm Martha Sigalski.
I'm Jim Payne. Just about a month left in the school year, and it's shaping up to be a tense stretch run.
In 2 days alone, four separate incidents around Central Florida and several teenagers in trouble. West News' Craig Lucy is live in Sanford tonight, where one of the scares involved a gun, Craig.
Martha, here at Millennium Middle School, I want to show you that these signs that are outside of all these different schools. Here, this one says it's a drug-free school zone. It is a felony to deal drugs. You can go to jail for a minimum of 3.5 years. Just below that, no guns, no weapons, and violators at the bottom will be prosecuted. Four different cases in 2 days, which has a lot of parents very concerned.
A pretty small handgun. It's a one-shot Derringer. It's a .22 caliber. It only takes one shot to kill somebody. I'm certainly glad.
Sanford police say a 13-year-old boy at Millennium Middle School showed up with this unloaded handgun and treated it like it was show and tell.
He was waving it, showing other kids at the school, hey, I've got a gun, which is a really bad idea.
We are not naming the boy, but did speak with his mother.
I forgot the thing was here. That gun been here over 13 years when my ex-husband was here.
She says her adopted son has been creating a lot of problems recently, but never with the law.
And it's devastating to have your child to do something like this.
Her child is not the only one scaring more and more students and parents.
It's very shocking to know that this kind of thing is going on.
Palm Bay police just arrested a 15-year-old student at Southwest Middle School after they say he made several bomb threats by placing a note on campus stating that he wanted to injure students and his parents. In Orlando, Glen Ridge Middle School was on lockdown as well after one student told another that he was going to kill him tomorrow. And the fourth scare at a school in only 2 days, O'Galley High School in Brevard County, where police found bomb-making instructions, wire cutters, knives, and bomb ingredients in 16-year-old Cameron Cage's backpack and locker.
It's like you don't feel like you're in a safe environment in school. Like, that's supposed to be like a second home.
In three of four of these cases, it was the students who contacted a school resource officer or a teacher, and police say that they are the heroes, and they hope that other students will follow their lead if they ever are faced with a similar incident. Reporting live in Sanford, Seminole County, Craig Lucy, West 2 News on CW 18.
Sex abuse allegations cast an unholy light on the Orlando Catholic Diocese once again.
New claims tonight against two local priests. One alleged victim says the abuse lasted for years. The silent suffering spanned decades.
West 2's Kendra Aistrank is live. And Kendra, the church is only standing by one of its holy men.
That's right, Jim. The diocese is defending Father Patrick Sheedy tonight. In fact, they're even considering a lawsuit against an attorney for defamation of character, dragging his name into this church sex scandal, while the victim of another priest is putting aside his shame and speaking out about the abuse he's endured.
I just pretty much kept it deep down inside.
Jason Bell has been keeping a dark secret for two decades.
I thought maybe I'd burn in hell.
Now the 34-year-old father of two is letting it out. He's suing his former priest, Father Richard Emerson, claiming he sexually abused him, dating back to 1988. Bell says for 5 years at St. Charles Borromeo Catholic Church in Orlando, the priest would give him alcohol, show him pornography, and fondle him and other boys at the church and the priest's home.
People do need to be aware of it. I mean, it goes on every day, and a lot of priests and popes, they turn the other cheek.
The diocese believes the allegations. The church has already settled two similar lawsuits against Emerson, who left Orlando in 1991 for his home parish in Indiana.
When one of us has been victimized, all of us are victimized.
But the diocese believes Father Patrick Sheedy is the victim when it comes to sex allegations against the Ocala pastor. Bell's attorney planned to also sue Sheedy on behalf of another victim, but held off as the diocese insisted it's not true.
It is unfortunate that someone has used his good name to claim an allegation of abuse.
It's almost a cancer.
Dr. Harvey Pittman teaches future priests at International Seminary School and believes sex scandals don't deter people called to serve, but may impact parishioners' faith in the church.
In some areas, I'm afraid, there's a falling off of church attendance.
Now, the diocese says it will work with Father Emerson's victim to settle this. He's asking for at least $15,000, while Father Sheedy will remain at his church, Blessed Trinity Church, in Ocala, while he fights these allegations. Live in downtown Orlando, Kendra Strike, West 2 News on CW18.
Much sadness tonight after the local man neighbors affectionately dubbed the Catman was found murdered in his home. Deputies found the elderly man dead in his Bithlow house after getting an anonymous 911 call. Investigators say evidence inside the house tells them it's murder. They haven't released his name yet. Neighbors already knew who it was, and here's why.
Give your shirt off his back. As old as he was, he'll take it off and give it to you. You know, he fed all the cats in the neighborhood. That's how we know him as Catman.
Investigators are questioning two neighbors who live next door. Longtimers call the two troublemakers. The man or woman who would challenge Barack Obama in the next presidential race will be chosen in our backyard.
The 2012 Republican National Convention is coming to Florida.
You and congratulate you for being selected as the host city for...
Pending formal approval from the National Committee, Republicans will crown their candidate just down I-4 from Orlando at the St. Pete Times Forum. Florida remains a swing state, and Republicans hope a home convention can put them over the top. Part of Tampa's pitch included the convention's close proximity to Orlando theme parks.
One man not on the GOP guest list right now, Governor Charlie Crist. Today, he formalized his split from the Republican Party when he officially registered for the U.S. Senate race with no party affiliation. He'll most likely be running against Republican Marco Rubio and Democrat Kendrick Meek.
Local beachgoers discovering a dead dolphin in Volusia County this morning. Researchers say the newborn dolphin was spotted in Ormond by the Sea. It showed signs of trauma that may have come from its mother. Baby dolphins have a high mortality rate. All new tonight, family members of a Polk County couple found shot to death at Winter Haven Hospital say their parents had a pact to die. The adult sons of Ramon and Patricia Duckworth spoke with the Lakeland Ledger. They say their parents talked about a murder-suicide and decided to do it together while she was in the hospital recovering from a stroke. Investigators think 77-year-old Ramon shot 76-year-old Patricia twice in the head and then killed himself. Detectives say they found this scrawled note near the bodies that they're now trying to decipher.
Mission managers have cleared Space Shuttle Atlantis for a liftoff one last time.
This Friday's launch will be the 32nd and final flight for Atlantis, and so far everything is looking pretty good.
Engineers say there's no technical troubles, and forecasters say there's a 70% chance the weather will cooperate. The six-member crew will deliver supplies to the International Space Station and perform maintenance during three spacewalks.
West 2 space expert Dan Billow joining us live right now. And Dan, only two shuttle missions remain after this one. After that, our manned space program is a big question mark. Now, the first and last men on the moon are launching on President Obama's new space plan.
Yes, and they are hoping to change that plan, Martha. These legends, Neil Armstrong and Gene Cernan, got a very friendly reception in a U.S. Senate committee room today. For Neil Armstrong to say anything in public is remarkable.
It's one small step for man.
You've heard Neil Armstrong say this.
One giant leap for mankind.
But you haven't heard the reclusive 79-year-old legend say much else until taking the President of the United States to task.
The new plan, as I understand it, will prohibit us from having human access to low Earth orbit on our own rockets and spacecraft.
Gene Cernan is famous for being the last man on the moon.
I was strolling on the moon.
He's even harder on Mr. Obama's plan to bring human spaceflight in the U.S. to an indefinite halt.
That this budget proposal presents no challenges, has no focus, and is in fact a blueprint for a mission to nowhere.
Neither man thinks private business can fly astronauts soon. The proposal summons up angry words.
Words like devastating, slide to mediocrity.
But having cut my teeth in rockets more than 50 years ago, I am not confident.
Senators jumped all over Obama's point man, Charlie Bolden.
It feels like we're losing leadership in the manned space.
Why do we want a half-baked Orion?
America needs to catch up in the world. We're behind in virtually everything we do.
A strong effort is underway in Congress to change the president's plan and have the United States build and fly its own spacecraft. This is a very important time. Congress will decide the future of U.S. spaceflight in the coming weeks. We're live in Cape Canaveral. Dan Billow, WESH 2 News on CW 18.
And Dan will be with us this Friday for the final launch of Space Shuttle Atlantis. We'll have the historic liftoff live on WESH 2 News and on WESH.com.
WESH 2 News 10 at 10 checking your weather right now here with Chief Meteorologist Tony Manolfi. And Tony, another quiet, comfortable night. We must be living right.
You got that right. We certainly are. And it's going to continue, Jim, for at least another 24 to 48 hours. Let me take you back outside here real quickly, show you what it looks like downtown Orlando. We are golden. We do have a little bit of a breeze out there. Winds are fairly light, and it's pretty comfortable. The overall pattern hasn't changed a whole lot. We still have that big ridge of high pressure to the east of us. Breezy late mornings and early afternoons, but the humidity is not high yet. A little bit later on in this broadcast, I'll let you know when the humidity is going to go back up. But the bottom line for us is with high pressure nearby, the biggest concern will be towards the beaches tomorrow and through Friday. Looks like that onshore flow is going to continue. Temps outside right now are running between 70 and 75. Daybreak temperatures, Jim and Martha, running upper 60s to low 70s near coast and low to the mid 60s as you work away farther inland.
Tony, thanks. Local police are looking for a man who rammed a cruiser and ran over an officer's toes. Daytona Beach police say the officer was checking on a suspicious vehicle on Martin Luther King Boulevard this morning. As she approached, the driver fired up the engine and rammed the cruiser twice. He also drove over the officer's foot, but she's okay. That driver is still on the run.
A Holly Hill police officer crashing early this morning while chasing a speeder. The officer lost control of his cruiser on Ridgewood Avenue. He ended up crashing into two vehicles in a used car lot. The officer suffered cuts and bruises, but is okay. The search for the other driver continues. Flames ate up an apartment in Orange County this morning. Firefighters arriving at the Citrus Glen apartment complex on Limelight Circle and found flames and heavy black smoke pouring out of the roof. They knocked down the fire in about 10 minutes. One apartment was damaged. The State Fire Marshal's office is now investigating.
A local spring break murder is solved after nearly two decades.
Next up at 10, the killer confession that cracked this case.
Then, late breaking right now, oil geyser under the sea. Our first look at the gusher causing one of the worst oil disasters in history.
A big deal at Disney. Next up at 10, WESH 2 revealing the plans for a new local resort.
And a Hollywood blockbuster filming in Central Florida. Tonight, the silver screen stars who will be here and when the action will begin. You're watching WESH 2 News at 10. Late breaking tonight, underwater video just released of the gushing oil leak in the Gulf of Mexico.
210,000 gallons of oil per day is blasting into the ocean. Officials say the color of the oil lightens when natural gas mixes with the oil. That's why this underwater video looks like it does.
BP also releasing new images of the cap that will hopefully stop the three-week-old leak. This two-ton top hat plug has been lowered underwater and will be hooked up tomorrow. There's now an estimated 4 million gallons of oil floating in the Gulf.
We do have some breaking news right now. A fire happening in Ocala is on Southeast 29th Terrace. We have learned that one woman was badly injured and a cat had to be rescued. Of course, we'll keep working the details and bring you a live report at 11.
A killer's confession has cracked a local cold case.
Nearly 20 years ago, a New York college student was murdered while visiting Volusia County here on spring break.
Now tonight, a man already locked up in Louisiana is coming clean. 38-year-old Romalis Gordon says he partied with 20-year-old Christine Lazaro at a Daytona Beach bar, then killed her 30 miles away in DeBary back in 1993. Local detectives say he wasn't on their radar until Gordon had a crisis of conscience.
He had found religion, that he had found God.
Gordon says at the time of the crime, he was wanted for armed robbery. He claims he killed Lazaro because he caught her looking through his fake IDs and feared she'd turn him in. Gordon is already serving two life sentences for a 2006 double murder. Right now, the Dutch government is rushing a support team to Libya to identify the little boy who's the sole survivor in a deadly plane crash. The 10-year-old boy from the Netherlands was the only one found alive this morning in the burning wreckage. He also has two broken legs. Everyone else was killed. 103 people. The Airbus crashed on approach to Tripoli Airport. Leaders say the weather for flying was perfect. Right now, they have no idea how the plane crashed.
Walt Disney's kingdom will soon stretch a little further in Central Florida. Disney announcing today it plans on opening a new resort in 2012. It will be called the Art of Animation Resort, and it's being billed as a value hotel. Rates could begin at $82 a night. Ground will be broken this summer on a 65-acre plot across the lake from Disney's Pop Century Resort.
We have found that, you know, there's demand for a suite product more than just a single room. And, of course, we have all the above here on property. And this is just an opportunity that larger family group can enjoy, or a smaller family group can just spread out a little bit.
The resort will have 2,000 rooms. It's expected to create more than 800 construction jobs. Young survivors of the earthquake in Haiti are here in Central Florida this week for a well-deserved vacation. 17 children arrived at the Nickelodeon Suites Resort in Orlando this afternoon. They've been hospitalized for months, undergoing reconstructive surgery and treatment. A surgeon from Miami organized the trip. The children went to Give Kids the World Village tonight, and they'll be also going to Universal Orlando.
The famed oil painting of Governor Charlie Crist has a new home. The Florida Republican Party announced today it sold a portrait of Crist on eBay for $7,700. The buyer wanted to remain anonymous. The painting was hanging in the lobby at the headquarters for the Republican Party until Crist announced he was running for the U.S. Senate as an independent.
Big transformations await the Space Coast, and it has nothing to do with the retiring shuttles.
Now, part of the next Transformers movie will be filmed at Kennedy Space Center. Director Michael Bay, Shia LaBeouf, Megan Fox, John Malkovich are all expected to be in Central Florida in September. Bay has been in Brevard County three times scouting out locations. A county commissioner says the filming could bring as much as $2 million to the local economy.
Local leaders hope this is just one of many big movies to film at the Space Coast. Of course, there have been others, including Apollo 13 in 1995, Marvin's Room in 1996, Armageddon in 1998, and Space Cowboys in 2000.
All welcome to come aboard. Enjoy the great weather that we have here in Central Florida.
They might want to stay.
Fabulous working conditions. Exactly our point.
Yeah, they might not go home. You're right. I'll tell you what. And it's going to continue right through Friday afternoon, Jim and Martha. Let me take you back outside. I'm sure some folks will be heading to Universal Orlando tomorrow with this spectacular weather. And I tell you what, if you've got plans for the theme parks this weekend, I think the weather is also going to cooperate. The temperature is going to be a little bit warmer, though. We'll talk more about that here in a second. All right, here's the setup. Big ridge of high pressure now due east of Orlando. We've got that south-southeasterly wind flow continuing tonight. Winds are slackening on off, and then a big storm system again cranking up. A couple reports of a few tornadoes tonight, but nothing like what we had a few days ago, earlier this week and over the weekend. There's that cold front. This energy stays north of us, begins to kind of weaken, and then a secondary impulse arrives across the southeastern half on the tail end of it towards Sunday and Monday. That will drive in a little bit of moisture our way as high pressure moisture breaks down, we're going to see some tropical moisture move in through the Bahamas and into central Florida, we think, beginning by Tuesday and Wednesday of next week. Breezy, pretty comfortable humidity levels yet again on Thursday. We're going to see the uptick, though, in the humidity values as we head into Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. If you head to the beach tomorrow, winds southeast, 5 to 15 miles an hour. Surf temps still a little bit on the cool side here. Still running in the low 70s, but the biggest concern tomorrow, watch out for those rip currents. The UV index, by the way, a very strong and powerful 11, so make sure you've got some good sunblock on. And the seas, 3 to 4 feet near coast, but 5 to 7 feet offshore with those long period swells. So if you're doing some deep sea fishing midweek, just be careful. Near shore temperatures tomorrow from Palm Coast, Daytona, Titusville, Melbourne Beach, running at 83, 84 degrees. Orlando, high 80s. West of Orlando, I think some of us will hit, if not even crack, the 90-degree mark beginning Thursday afternoon. Friday, not much change. Rip current still a concern. Big ridge of high pressure nearby. There goes that first disturbance, and then a secondary disturbance gets cranked up. Northeast Texas over towards Louisiana late in the weekend. This front will move in by early next week. That, combined with high pressure being squashed a little bit farther south and east, and some moisture coming in from the southwest, that means a return to afternoon showers and thunderstorms beginning early next week. All right, Atlantis launch time, 2:20. The only real concern here, just a few little clouds. I think we're going to get this one off without any issues. Winds are going to be fairly light, southeast 5 to 15. 7-day forecast, 90 back in Orlando on Friday. Sticking and staying through the weekend. Rain chances going up early next week.